Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Well, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Welcome, everybody, on this beautiful, beautiful third Sunday of Easter. What a gorgeous spring day. It's just a delight to see all of you all out here today. For those joining us on our YouTube channel, welcome to Mitchell's Presbyterian Church. I'm Reverend Michael Klang, the covenant pastor here, and it's just a delight and a joy that you're tuned in on our channel, and it's our hope and prayer that the time that you're with us will be a real blessing to you. Announcements. I know I have one. I think everybody might have seen the announcement that came out in the email in regards to the Christian Education Committee meeting happening this week at in the Fellowship Hall at 6 o'clock on Wednesday. We need teachers. And if God has placed that calling upon your heart, now's a good time to think about it and maybe respond to that. There's, from what Becky had said, we've got young adults ranging from 6 to 16 and regular adults just of all different age groups. So again, if you've got that burning desire and feel that answer to God's call, please, please, show up on Wednesday. Any other announcements that anybody needs to make? Did I get all that right, Becky? Is that good? Yes. Yes, please. So these beautiful arrangements, yeah, from the Tidman family in honor of loved ones and to the glory of God. So, thank you. Yeah, They're beautiful. Yes, they're gorgeous. Yes, it's all so beautiful up here. Yes. Well, many of you are aware, and maybe not everybody does know, but next Sunday will be my last Sunday with you all here at Mitchell's. Very bittersweet for me, to say the least. Tracy and I are going to be going out west to spend a little more time with some family that we have out there, and that part's exciting, but leaves kind of a big hole in our heart, you know, because you all have been more than a blessing to me. So I, you know, I'm going to get tearful here. But we never say never. We don't know how our roads may intertwine again. God works in such mysterious ways. So we're keeping everything open. And my true hope and prayer is that there's somebody sitting out there right now who's starting to feel that burn about needing to be here with you guys, this wonderful congregation. So that's my hope and prayer. But again, just to let you know this, next Sunday will be my last one here. And I will always be keeping you in my thoughts and prayers. So remember that we are united together as one, wherever we may be this day. So let us now call ourselves to worship with the call that's printed in our bulletin. God has been gracious to us and heard our prayers.
God has put gladness in our hearts.
We shall live in peace.
For God alone is our dwelling place.
Our hymn of adoration this morning, number 150, Come Christians, Join to Sing. So I'd invite you to stand as you're able as we sing hymn 150. Gather together this morning, let's affirm what we believe by reciting together our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Well, the resurrected Christ has come into our midst, inviting us to repentance and forgiveness today. Our journeys may have taken us far from God, but the hospitality of Christ welcomes us home. So let's now confess our sins by reciting together our confession. Holy and merciful God, in your presence, we confess our failure to be what you created us to be. You alone know how often we have sinned in wandering from your ways, in wasting our gifts, in forgetting your love. By your loving mercy, help us to live in your light and abide in your ways. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. The old is gone. Behold, the new has come. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, choir. Join me in prayer. God of the Word, open our hearts and minds and give us the courage to hear your word as we read the words of Scripture today. And by the power of your Spirit, illuminate our paths. Amen. Well, our lessons today, actually both, I'm going to just read the first one now, comes to us from Luke 24. We're going to start with 28 through 35. We're dropping right in on Jesus and his two of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Hear these words today. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the Scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Word of God. Thanks be to God. Well, our litany response today in our pastoral prayer will be, "God of resurrection, hear our prayer." The psalmist says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good," which to me is that invitation just to pause, just reflect on what God is doing in each of our lives. So for the next 30 seconds, I would just invite you just to pause and just to reflect on how God has been in your life this week. And just allow each breath to refresh your spirit and calm any anxiety that you have. And let's just breathe and reflect on God for the next 30 seconds. And then we'll pray. God, today we pray for the church throughout the world, that as we celebrate the great 50 days of Easter, we may renew our faith and strength and strengthen our witness in Jesus' name. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For pastors and teachers and ministers, that they recognize the risen Christ in word and sacrament, and lead your church with wisdom, humility, and courage. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For the governments of the world and their leaders, especially our president, President Biden, and our governor, Governor Northam, that they may resist the corruption of sin and serve the common good of all. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For those places in our world that are suffering, Myanmar, St. Vincent, Haiti, and for all those places struggling with gun violence, may you bring peace and healing. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. for the poor and the stranger, that they may receive a place of refuge and hope, and that the church may offer the hospitality the disciples offered to Jesus. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. And for the sick, those in distress, and all of those on our prayer list this morning, may they find healing for their pain and be restored to wholeness, to fullness of life. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. God of all power and glory, receive these prayers and continue your mighty work among us. Through Jesus Christ, our living Lord, who taught us the prayer, we all now pray together in unison. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, the earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it. Thanks, everyone who has continued to send in your tithes and offerings to the church office. As a reminder, we do have a collection plate with envelopes in the narthex and in the fellowship hall. So if you need to make an offering today, there's two places for you to do it. And for those that we have received this week, let us now stand as we are able and give thanks with the singing of our doxology. Let's pray. Almighty God, by your grace, accept the fruits of our labor and the offerings of our lives. Let us be a sacrifice of thanksgiving in union with our risen Lord, who lives and reigns with you forever. Amen. Our hymn of devotion will be number 333, Seek Ye First, number 333. Let us sing. Please be seated. Our second reading continues on in Luke. We're going to read now from 36 to 48. So while they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and touch my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving, and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Friends, the words of God, the stories of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Join me once again in prayer. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock, our strength, and our redeemer. Amen. Well, a few weeks ago, Tracy and I had a small technological meltdown when her computer, for reasons that we will never know, just decided, as if it had a mind of its own, which we know that it does, would no longer boot up. It was frozen, and nothing we could do would fix it. We called tech support. Nothing. We called the Geek Squad. Nope. We eventually took it to a random repair shop, and it's by some miracle from heaven, they were able to restart it in safe mode. Now, the problem was all the files and programs were gone. Now, fortunately, we had backups, so after hours of waiting and occasionally screaming at the computer, especially when I had forgotten a few of the passwords, all was restored. Thank God. Technology got me thinking. We have this real love-hate with it, don't we? I was sharing some things with my nephew, some of the changes we've seen over the years. I said, "Remember the VCR? Always with that flashing clock on the front, unless you were savvy enough to know how to program it," which was the real beauty of those devices, right? Being able to record shows while you were away. However, who here recorded a show and with just minutes to go, either ran out of tape or the timer stopped? I know I did. Or who recorded over their favorite episode of a show they wanted to watch again? Yes. Well, I will say I love no longer having to program my VCR. Rather, I can just stream to my heart's content on Netflix or Hulu. I love it. Problem is now, though, you sit down to watch a show and you end up binge-watching to all hours of the morning because writers are so clever how they do each episode. You think all is going along smoothly with the characters, and then boom, something happens. You just got to watch the next episode to see how it resolves. But thankfully, most good writers, as the season is ending, they tie up most of the loose ends and then skillfully whet your appetite for the next season. Well, that's what's going on with Luke's gospel today. We've heard about the resurrection. Jesus has now appeared to some of his disciples, and Luke is going to whet our appetite for the next season of the Acts of the Apostles by telling the disciples to just hang out until power from on high comes to you. Sounds like a pretty good episode to me. But he also needed to tie up a few loose ends. So as we enter today's reading, the disciples, they're sitting around talking, no doubt about Jesus' death and the bizarre rumors circulating about his missing body, when he appears in their midst, seemingly out of nowhere. They respond with terror, as maybe any of us would do if one of our deceased loved ones suddenly showed up in our living room. To calm their fears, Jesus offers his friends the tactile testimony of his body. "Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones." Now, Luke doesn't tell us whether the disciples take Jesus up on this offer. Maybe the braver ones extend a trembling finger and poke at Jesus' skin, or lean in closer to look at those scarred feet. All the while, the maybe spooked or timid ones hold back. And when the hands and the feet, they prove inadequate to convince the disciples of his physical appearance, he offers his stomach. "Have you anything to eat?" The disciples hand him a piece of broiled fish, and he takes it and eats it in their presence. It's a simple act, but one that shifts the story. As Jesus chews and swallows the fish, something becomes possible that was impossible before. The disciples lose enough of the fear to actually draw close and listen to what Jesus is saying. This new receptivity allows Jesus to open their minds to understand. I just love the humanness and physicality that Jesus shows in this story. It's in the presence of skin and bones and taste buds and nerve endings that the disciples come to believe. In fact, if you look closely, all of Jesus' post-resurrection appearances in the Gospels center on the physical. He doesn't show up in some disembodied voice relaying final instructions to his disciples. He shows up with his hands and his feet, scars and wounds. He receives the tearful embrace of Mary Magdalene, who wasn't one to let him go. He makes footprints on the Emmaus Road with two bewildered disciples. He tears into hunks of bread with his scarred hands. He chews on a piece of tilapia. He makes a campfire on the beach and cooks breakfast for his friends. This is what Luke is trying to get across in this final episode, that this embodied Jesus of Easter is the same Jesus we have seen in the Gospels. That this Jesus of Easter is the Jesus of the Incarnation. The Jesus who grows in a womb, enters the world through a birth canal, sleeps in a feeding trough, and nurses at Mary's breast. The Jesus who scrapes his knees, roughhouses with playmates, loses his parents during Passover, and goes through puberty in the backwaters of Nazareth. The Jesus who soaks in the waters of baptism, hungers for bread in the Judean wilderness, weeps at his friend's grave, flings a whip around at the temple, appreciates oil on his feet and hands, sweats blood in the Garden of Gethsemane, and suffers asphyxiation on a Roman cross. "It is I," Jesus tells his disciples as they struggle to reorder all that they know about life and death in the aftermath of this astonishing appearance. "It is I, the one you know, the one you love, the one you trust. Touch me and see. Keep calm and pass me some fish." By the end of this encounter, They're no longer frightened human beings. They are now witnesses to all these things. They're emboldened for life and ministry. And that's the final point that Luke wanted to stress. The point he will unpack for us in the next season, that being a witness to all of these things is testifying, not just with our words, but more importantly, with our actions. Remember, the next season is called the Acts of the Apostles, not the words or ruminations of the apostles. To be a witness is to carry on this embodied flesh and blood ministry of Jesus, who gave his mission statement right at the beginning in the sermon that almost got him thrown off a cliff. The Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, release of the captive, sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free. To be a witness will be to do what Jesus did and more. Remember what he told the disciples. Truly I tell you, trust in me and you will do greater works than these. So how are we embodying it? A few months after the devastating earthquake that hit Haiti back in 2010, a good friend of our family, he took a break from his medical practice to participate on a medical mission team. While only in Haiti a week, the experience of ministering to those impacted by this tragedy changed him. In the following months, he took a sabbatical from his practice and moved with his family to Mbombo in Zululand, South Africa, to become one of a handful of physicians covering the entirety of a rural bush hospital in this very remote village. And while, yes, there were exciting adventures being so close to game parks with rhinos and elephants, there were stressful times of being an internal medicine physician covering everything from trauma to obstetrics in the middle of the night. The stories he said and told us give you chills, but they also made you smile as you realized the love and care and compassion that he and his family brought to this community. He's returned now to the States, but he's in a different practice now with a different perspective on the world. Now, few of us might have the opportunity or be able to go to the African bush, but there are hundreds upon hundreds of ways, both big and small, that we too can embody Christ in this world. Volunteering time at a clinic or food bank, visiting those who are shut in, cooking someone a meal or sharing the bounty of your garden, helping someone fix a car or doing some carpentry work, tutoring kids or teaching Sunday school, or just being that listening ear to someone in need. In today's season finale, Luke wants to make it clear that the physical, earthly, flesh and blood world, it's real and it's valuable. Real and valuable enough for God to inhabit it in the person of Jesus of Nazareth and in the person of the risen Lord. To affirm the resurrection is not to affirm that Jesus is taken out of this world. Luke puts the risen Christ right back into the world. See my hands and feet? Touch me. Writer and theologian Rob Bell summed it up nice. He said, "The goal of Christianity isn't escaping the world, but making this world the kind of place God can come to." Keep calm and pass the fish. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. God, may we be doers of your word and not just hearers. Continue to fill us with the presence of your Spirit so that we may be a witness to all these things by showing your love and works to all of the world. Amen. Well, our hymn of dedication is going to be number 366, Jesus, Thy Boundless Love to Me. I would invite you to stand as you're able as we sing number 366. Well, Luke wants to remind us that in the risen Christ, we serve a God that is incarnational, flesh and blood. And so as witnesses to these things, we are the hands and feet of Christ. May we get these hands and feet dirty in serving the Lord. You all are amazing. Hugs to you guys. Have an awesome, awesome week. Receive now this benediction. Let these words flow over you today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. God's shalom today and every day. Amen.